Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mark Dirks, and on behalf of ACRL and Choice, I'd like to welcome you to today's program, LGBTQ History, Supporting Diversity in Research and Teaching and Why It Matters, which is sponsored by ProQuest. Today's discussion is one in a series of sponsored webinars from ACRL and Choice that addresses new ideas, developments, and products of interest to the academic library community. Free to users, these structured 60-minute live presentations provide the opportunity for interactive discussions of important new issues and developments in academic librarianship by librarians, vendors, authors, and other interested stakeholders. Before we get started, I'd like to point out a few features of the webinar software. In the main area of the screen, you should be able to follow along with the presentation materials. Along the right-hand side, you may see a Q&A panel or a chat panel. If you don't, you can click the button on the bottom of your screen that's trying hard to look like a dialogue cloud. And if you're looking for the Q&A, you can click the three little dots, and that will open up more options where you can find the Q&A panel. Please use the Q&A panel to submit questions to our speakers. At the end of the presentation, they will take a few minutes to answer your questions, so again, please do send in questions throughout. And if you experience any technical issues, please use the chat panel to let me know, and I'll troubleshoot the issue with you privately. Today, we're using the hashtag ACRLChoiceWebinars during the event, so if you have another screen handy, shout out to us. We're at choice_reviews on Twitter. Also note that we are recording today's program, and everyone who registered should receive a follow-up email with a link to the archived version. All right, our speakers today are Nancy Unger and Barbara Olson. Nancy Unger is professor and chair of the History Department at Santa Clara University, and Barbara Olson is the lead product marketing manager for ProQuest. With that, we are ready to get started, so I'll turn the floor over to you, Nancy.
Okay, so I am delighted to be participating in my very first webinar, and my thanks to ACRL Choice for offering this webinar and to ProQuest for sponsoring it. It's been my pleasure to have worked with ProQuest, Daniel Lewis, and Barbara Olson in the past. This time, I got to work as well with Lynette Bone and the amazing Mark Dirks, who helped me to overcome my technological phobias. I am grateful for this opportunity to talk about one of my great passions, which is researching, teaching, and promoting LGBTQ history. I also want to thank all of you for attending this webinar, and I look forward to your questions and feedback. So I'm going to start talking a little bit about myself and then why I really believe LGBTQ history matters. Then we'll go into a fair amount of sample content. So we're going to start off briskly talking about sodomy in colonial New England, the trials of Nicholas Senchin and Stephen Gorton and their significance. We'll move on to early African and African-American same-sex history. Same-sex communities in the Old West. Can we call cowboys and miners gay? We'll move on to women who pass as men. We'll talk about Boston marriages, the Beware the Homosexual campaigns, and the rise of lesbian and gay stereotypes. We'll also spend some time talking about lesbian alternative environments in the 60s and 70s, and then talk about the power of ProQuest and really advancing this kind of study, and then a few conclusions. So first, just a little bit about me. So anyway, there I am. That's me. I was trained as a political historian, and much of my work centers on the Gilded Age and Progressive Era at the turn of the last century. So. There we go. So on the left is my first book, Fighting Bob La Follette, The Righteous Reformer. And on the right, my most recent volume, the co-edited companion to the Gilded Age and Progressive Era. I began my teaching career at San Francisco State University, and I had been there There we go. All right. I've been there. I'm so sorry for everyone. I think I've got it now. I had been there a few semesters at San Francisco State when my department chair, Bob Cherney, told me that he had me on the schedule teaching California history for the next term. And I said, you know, Bob, I wasn't raised in California. I've never taken California history, and I don't know anything about it. And he said, you know, Nancy, here at San Francisco State, we don't let little things like that get in our way. So I've always preferred designing new courses over unemployment, which is how I ended up teaching entire courses and even publishing on all kinds of things for which I have no formal training. So despite my lack of training in women's history, I teach it regularly, and I wrote this gender-infused biography, Belle La Follette, Progressive Era Reformer. For years, I taught environmental history and wrote this book, Beyond Nature's Housekeepers, American Women in Environmental History, which is kind of a double dipper in ignorance, as I have no training in women's history or environmental history. I've taught history of the American West, historical geography, American colonies and constitution, and, of course, LGBTQ history. In the beginning, I really was doing more of the left-hand side of this slide, what I called straight, gay, and lesbian. But over the years, in part due to student requests, I've incorporated more of the bi, trans, questioning, and more of the overarching sort of queer aspects. And so how did this particular course come to be? The very first class of any kind that I ever taught was in 1986. It was a night class at San Francisco State, focusing on the second half of the U.S. survey. And to make the point that there was some aspect of American history that would appeal to everyone, I asked the students to write a review of any American history book. And my long list of titles included this one. Titles I suggested included this one. John DiMillo's Sexual Politics, Sexual Communities, The Making of a Homosexual Minority in the United States, 1940 to 1970. And a student wrote a great review, and then he hand-wrote at the bottom, "Thank you for suggesting this book. As a gay man, I didn't know I had a history." Well, and you can imagine my reaction. I mean, in the words of Hannah Arendt, if we do not know our own history, we are doomed to live it as though it were our private fate. Understanding your history helps you to understand its role in your life. I mean, it's very empowering. So I read the DiMillo book myself and made it a point to include more gay and lesbian history content in all of my classes. This August, I was snorkeling in Maui, and I saw a hat about 15 feet down. And at first, I thought it was one of those MAGA hats, you know, Make America Great Again. But I dove down and got it, and it was a pretty beat-up version of this hat, Make America Gay Again. And I got such a kick out of it. It was a rare acknowledgement in popular culture of the long gay past. Because once you start looking for appropriate gay history content, it's everywhere and in every period of American history. It didn't just begin with the Stonewall Riots of 1969 that really kicked off the modern gay and lesbian liberation movement. So I didn't have to stretch or include token representation throughout all of my courses. So a group of students came and asked me to offer a specific lesbian and gay history class. And I put the course together, and I got it approved by the curriculum committee, but I couldn't offer it because I was only a lecturer. Somebody else actually taught it. In 1994, I came here to Santa Clara University, which is a Jesuit Catholic institution. So I figured such a course was probably now off the table. But it was actually one of the Jesuits who saw on my CV that I developed it, and he asked me to teach it. So I began offering lesbians and gays in U.S. history in 2002, and it's been offered every year since, and it's been a huge success and almost always has a pretty long waiting list. I wrote in 2007 this article, Teaching Straight Gay and Lesbian History, and I got more immediate responses to this than any of the other 15 scholarly articles that I've published. Ultimately, this article was anthologized into this book, Teaching American History, and it was a proud moment for all of us contributors when it was denounced on Fox Television News. Emails came to me primarily from professors and high school teachers all across the country, and most of them wanted advice on how to persuade hostile administrators to let them teach some LGBTQ content. That content is now mandated in public schools in four states, including California, and I think that number is only going to rise. Earlier this month, I gave an hour-long presentation to 40 high school teachers about the kind of content they might include if they incorporate LGBTQ material into their history classes. It is such a rapidly growing discipline. Courses, articles, books, documentary films. Teachers, students, and scholars are all looking for good materials. And in a few minutes, I'm going to talk about how ProQuest is a leader in the effort to meet that growing demand. But first, why does supporting diversity in the research and teaching of LGBTQ history matter? It is enormously gratifying to me how much the course has meant to my students. They love it. No student ever says, oh my God, gay and lesbian history again. But they know all the signposts, the colonial period, the Great Depression, the Cold War, etc. And so they're learning new things, but in a familiar context. I don't ask about their sexuality, but often it comes out in class discussions. They say things like, my mom's a lesbian, or I'm gay, or I'm bi, my dad is trans. And a lot say, I'm straight, but this is an aspect of history I want to know more about. The anonymous evaluations of the course emphasize how much it gives students a substantially fuller grasp of American history. In other words, it's not in a separate silo. I mean, I think any U.S. history course should do that. But what I find most gratifying are the LGBTQ students who tell me how much it meant to them to know they have a history. A long, complicated history full of passion and oppression and pain and joy and protest and reform. They find it comforting and infuriating and tragic and inspiring and always empowering. Now, because I believe so strongly in this, I've done a lot of public outreach on this subject. C-SPAN asked if they could come film one of my gay history classes. It was broadcast nationally and has been viewed more than 3,000 times in their online library. I've published a number of op-eds, including this one published by Time right after the mass murder at the Pulse nightclub. And that piece prompted an invitation from Birmingham, Alabama, to give a talk there, a talk that was also broadcast nationally on C-SPAN. It, too, is in their online library, where it's also been viewed a couple thousand times. I've talked about LGBTQ history at the Commonwealth Club in San Francisco, as the keynote speaker at a conference, on college campuses, to community groups, to the EPA, on the radio. I'll talk to anyone who will listen. Next month, I'll be presenting on this topic at NASA, for crying out loud. Now, C-SPAN warned me that I would get hate mail, and I have, but it's greatly outnumbered by my fan mail, and that mail includes things like a note from a straight truck driver who was flipping through the channels in his hotel room after a long day's long haul and was fascinated by this history he didn't know. Much of the mail comes from LGBTQ folk, many of whom thank me for telling the story of their people, and some for telling me what they see as their personal story. One viewer, for example, wrote, although I am a gay man of 62 years and possess a relatively strong knowledge of gay history, I learned a great deal from your valuable talk. I feel that your efforts at educating the public go a great distance towards chipping away at homophobia and serve to bring me an additional sense of pride as a gay man. so many viewers have really been moved and often very surprised by what they learn. I mean, this history matters. And it's really fun history to do. It includes legal, racial, social, economic, religious, and political components. I'm going to give you a very quick sampling of some subject matter, and I'm going to talk mostly about earlier American history because this is the material that is less well known. Now, I start my course with pre-Columbian Native Americans, and then we move on, because who doesn't want to read the assigned article, Sodomy in Colonial New England? It's such a surprising topic, because we learned that the early colonists were unexpectedly tolerant of same-sex sex. Nicholas Senchin, who'd been known to force himself upon other men sexually and warned to knock it off for decades, was finally brought to trial in 1677, and he was found guilty of attempted sodomy. His punishment? The threat that he'd forfeit his fortune if he ever did it again. End of story. No jail, no fines, no public outrage or shunning or even distancing. In 1725, Stephen Gorton appeared in a New London, Connecticut court for, quote, having lasciviously behaved himself towards sundry men, endeavoring to commit sodomy with them, close quote. The charges were dismissed for lack of evidence. Yet more than 30 years later, in 1756, Gorton was suspended from his position as Baptist minister for, quote, unchaste behavior with his fellow men when in bed with them. He's the Baptist minister, but he repents, and two-thirds of his church membership votes him back in. End of story. No punishment, no fines, no shunning. In the colonial period, same-sex acts were seen primarily as just that, actions, not identities. Being a contributing member of the community, that was what was really valued, that was what mattered. We talk about the common misperception among some conservatives in Africa and in the African American community that homosexuality is a sign of weakness, that gay male sex in particular is un-African, an unmanly adoption of white ways. This homophobic notion does a disservice to the history of black men in two ways. It ignores the tradition of boy wives in pre-colonial Africa, and it also ignores the very early colonial period when slave owners, valuing brute strength, purchased male slaves disproportionately. Bereft of women, some same-sex sexuality created some of the only intimacy, love, and comfort among male slaves in the 1600s. This also ignores as well the possibility that for a couple of centuries, enslaved men and boys, as well as enslaved women and girls, were subject to rape by their white masters. Same-sex desire has always been a part of American history, but so long as the nation remained primarily agricultural, heterosexual family units prevailed out of economic necessity. There were some exceptions in early single-sex communities. There had been a long tradition in Europe, including among pirates. What kind of man would choose to be a merchant sailor, a cowboy, a miner? Certainly, it had economic appeal for men, including African Americans, who had few other economic opportunities. But did it also appeal disproportionately to men who enjoyed same-sex relations? Some of these communities had traditions of accepting same-sex intimacy. But what does all this really prove? Are all men in single-sex communities having sex with other men? No. But you're either going to abstain, masturbate, have sex with animals, or with other men, at least until female prostitutes become available and affordable. And we do have some firsthand accounts of same-sex sex. But can we call these men gay? According to scholar Peter Bogue, these men were not looked down upon as effeminate or in any way unmanly. Quote, in all men's societies, it was not unusual for same-sex relationships. and it was just an acceptable thing to do. People engaged in same-sex activities weren't seen as homosexuals, close quote. They're just men making do. Same-sex sexual activity was seen as just that, an activity, not an identity. As the nation became increasingly urban, there came the possibility of what we would call today a gay lifestyle. Men paid in wages did not have to marry and have children to survive, and they could find men with similar desires in the growing urban centers where we find more evidence of gay men, often through arrest records for sex in public places, but also from letters and diaries. So far, this talk has focused a lot on male sexuality. Where are the women? As the nation developed, most women were allowed fewer freedoms than men, and even as the nation urbanized, tended to live more sequestered lives. Young women's crushes on other women, or smashes as they were called, were often noted by their parents, but not particularly feared, as a heterosexual marriage was women's ultimate and really only ambition. So you can imagine historians' excitement when we found evidence of women passing as men. So we did it. We found the lesbians. Well, as it turns out, some women who passed as men and married other women were undoubtedly lesbian. Others were what we would call today trans. But why else would they live as men? Well, for a lot of good reasons. Born Cora Anderson, Ralph Carwinio's secret was discovered in 1914. He explained that living as a man allowed him to earn substantially higher wages, spend much less money on clothes, and it kept men from constantly harassing him. Married twice to women, he wanted to be free to live in the world made by men. Other women who passed as men spoke of their ability to vote, to walk the streets alone, even at night, and to enjoy independence and autonomy. So some of these passing women were lesbians, some trans, and some may have been straight. Historians kept looking and found Boston marriages, which thrived in the late 1800s. These are professional women, many of whom graduated from the new elite women's colleges in the Boston area. They entered into lifelong partnerships with other women. So these include the reformer Jane Addams and Mary Smith, Mount Holyoke professor Jeanette Marks and the college president Mary Woolley, and M. Carey Thomas, president of Bryn Mawr, and Mamie Gwynn. So we did it. We found the lesbians. Or did we? A lady, even if she was one of these very few who earned enough money to be self-sufficient, simply did not live alone. Like passing as a man, being with another woman is what allowed a lady to have a career, to travel, to enjoy all the independence that came with not being a subservient wife. Some of these elite women in Boston marriages were straight, but certainly some were lesbian. And often our evidence is lack of evidence. According to historian Estelle Friedman, when prison reformer Miriam Van Waters was being investigated on charges of lesbianism with Geraldine Thompson, for days her diary entries note only, "The burning of letters continues. The burning of letters continues," as the evidence was destroyed. Hard evidence of sex between women is not entirely lacking, however. Anarchist and free love advocate Emma Goldman enjoyed a sexual relationship with Elmida Sperry. How can I speak with such certainty of something so intimate and private? Here's what Sperry wrote to Goldman in 1912. "Dearest, if I had only enough courage to kill myself when you reached your climax, then I would have known happiness, for at that moment I had complete possession of you. I wish to escape from you, but I am harried from place to place in my thoughts. I cannot escape from the rhythmic spurt of your love juice." So I don't feel like I'm really going out on a limb when we say that, you know, we did find lesbian sexual activity. Now, originally, Boston marriages were socially accepted, just two ladies living together. And images like these of men and college women cross-dressing, oh, just harmless fun. But those practices coincided with something else that would soon make them suspect, an increasing awareness of the new concept, ultimately termed homosexuality. We see the medicalization of same-sex desire beginning in the 1870s and 80s. At first, the doctor's diagnosis was inversion rather than homosexuality. Inverts, they claimed, think, act, and feel the opposite of their biological sex. This caused a lot of confusion, as men like Walt Whitman, who readily acknowledges attraction to other men, denies that he's an invert because he doesn't see himself as a woman trapped in a man's body. He doesn't think his feelings are pathological. He's just a man who loves other men. The term homosexual comes into print in the U.S. in 1892 and affirmed that the person's general mental state is that of the opposite sex. Same-sex desire and behavior now has a name, and it is defined as deviant. It's a pathology, a sickness. Arrests of men began to pick up in the 1880s, so it's also increasingly prosecuted as a crime. And with the presidency of hyper-masculine Theodore Roosevelt in 1901, just as Americans are increasingly sort of discovering male homosexuality, it's being equated with not just effeminacy, but cowardice, unnaturalness, impotence, lack of patriotism. It's un-American. And it's amazing how readily recognizable the resultant stereotypes had already become. So Roosevelt strongly advocated U.S. entry into World War I. Here, limp-wristed Uncle Sam has come riding up in a car driven by a peace dove and says to Roosevelt, who's dressed as a warrior, "Theodore, if you don't stop taunting me about unpreparedness, I'll just slap you on the wrist." Here's another limp-wristed character, the conscientious objector during the war. "Oh, you naughty German, you naughty, unkind German. Really, if you don't desist, I'll forget I've got a conscience and I'll smack you on the wrist." Here, Europe, being assaulted by Bolshevism, calls to the limp-wristed and obviously impotent Paris Peace Conference, "Officer, call a real policeman." Now, you can imagine what all this talk of inversion and homosexuality does to Boston marriages and intimate friendships between women and between men. There arose "Beware the Homosexual" campaigns that ended up a lot like the "Beware of Strangers" campaign of my childhood. To keep us safe from child predators, we were told to beware of strangers, who were depicted as men wearing trench coats and fedoras. So the campaign backfired, as we kids were all wary of strange men in trench coats and fedoras, not the family friends or member of our extended circle of relatives who actually constituted the real danger in the vast majority of cases. The "Beware the Homosexual" campaign backfired in the same kind of way. Beware the ultra-feminine, limp-wristed man. Well, homosexual men who didn't fulfill that stereotype were much less subject to suspicion and harassment. And beware the lesbian. How will you know her? The description seems to have been based on the British author Radcliffe Hall. "The lesbian hates men but looks mannish herself. She has short hair and wears low-heeled shoes. She may even wear trousers." So any lesbian who didn't fit that description was also much more likely to rise above suspicion. And the results are fascinating. Remember that 1912 letter from Elmita Sperry to Emma Goldman? Now, we know that Goldman has enjoyed sex with women, and she's no hypocrite. Yet she writes to a friend, "Really, the lesbians are a crazy lot. Their antagonism to the male is almost a disease with them. I simply cannot bear such narrowness." She's not one of these man-hating lesbians. She's just a woman who likes to have sex with other women. Likewise, Mary Casale described her sexual relationship with another woman as the very highest type of love, insisting that, quote, "our lives were on a much higher plane than those of the real inverts. While we did indulge in our sexual intercourse, that was never the thought uppermost in our minds." We're now going to make a big leap forward in time. One of my research areas is the lesbian alternative environments of the 1970s and 1980s, and it's the subject of a chapter in my environmental book. Beginning in the 1970s, especially in Southern Oregon, a flood of lesbians joined the Back to the Land movement. They sought to create a new, viable, and sustainable alternative to patriarchy and capitalism. One resident recalls, "So much of the Back to the Land movement was about coming out and coming into our power and identities as lesbians. We intuitively knew that we had to get out of the patriarchal cities and redefine ourselves and our lives. We actually tried to build a new culture, not just back to the land, but back to ourselves. And this new culture included, quote, a desire to live lightly on Mother Earth and in sympathy with nature," close quote. Women erected or adapted from existing shacks and cabins, small housing units that were easy to build and manage. These tiny residences represented safety, economy, and autonomy. Instead of celebrating unbridled production, this new culture valued salvaging, recycling, and handcrafted materials. Sophisticated technology, heavy machinery, and animal products were eschewed by these women in favor of solar power, hand tools, and vegetarian organic foods in their desire to protect the environment as part of a larger effort to combat the evils of patriarchy and heterosexism. As one informational pamphlet from the Oregon Women's Trust Land Trust put it, "We want to be stewards of the land, treating her not as a commodity, but as a full partner and guide in this exploration of who we are." They faced all kinds of problems, not the least of which was their inability to attract lesbians of color, and just the fact that living off the land is really hard. But even as some of their early communal efforts fell apart, none of the lesbians involved termed their experiments a failure. They spoke of the empowerment they found in doing things for themselves, and their recognition that nature is not an abstraction to be idealized, nor is it an other to be feared, tamed, subdued, or exploited, but rather, quote, a friend, a sister, a lover, not to mention a workplace, a home, a refuge, and on some days, a nuisance, close quote. These lesbians proved that there were ways of living that, however imperfect, did not hinge on profit or patriarchy, and that instead allowed lesbians to live openly, freely, and consciously as partners with nature. Much of the original primary source material for this research was housed in archives back east. It meant leaving my then young family and spending a great deal of time, energy, and money traveling. I know that subscribing to databases is never cheap, and a few of us are at institutions where budgets are expanding. Nevertheless, I would have given a lot to have some of these ProQuest databases when I was doing my environmental research. I marvel at the convenience and ease of use of these digitized collections, and I encourage you to consider the full range of primary documents already made available through ProQuest in addition to their LGBTQ databases. I'll talk about those in a second. But first, I mean, I almost fainted when I learned that they digitized three women's studies manuscript collections from the Schlesinger Library: voting rights, national politics, and reproductive rights. If you've ever conducted research at the Schlesinger Library in the summer, and I have, you know they keep it so cold in there you can practically see your own breath. It would be heaven to look through these materials at a comfortable temperature and not have to travel all the way to Cambridge. I almost fainted again when I saw that ProQuest has also digitized plantation records as part of their Southern Life and African American History collection. To consult some of those same plantation records, I had to travel to the Sally Bingham Center for Women's History and Culture at Duke University. North Carolina is lovely, but working from home is a delight. And I sure could have used ProQuest LGBT Thought and Culture Archive as well. That collection includes primary documents such as this cool flyer and a six-page newsletter produced by the Wisconsin Women's Land Cooperative. The LGBT studies in video includes the documentary film Back to the Land and Coming of Age in Cherry Grove, The Invasion, all just wonderful sources. Now, I fear that I'm beginning to sound a bit like my curmudgeon-y colleague who grumbles resentfully about how scholars have it so easy today. To be clear, while I love to play the martyr, I am delighted for my profession by these advances. While access to these collections is not free, ease of use and the immediate and unlimited availability to subscribers seems to me to be a giant leap forward in our ability to carry out original, meaningful research. To be able to conduct in an instant a search, to download documents, and to be able to do so from a laptop anywhere, this is modern research at its most convenient and efficient. It moves this research out of the realm of only the most dedicated scholar committed to extensive time and travel and into the hands of almost anyone. Professional academics, graduate students, even undergraduates now have the opportunity to conduct primary research. I'm very much a generalist when I offer my LGBTQ course, and I find that my students' research is best when I give them free rein to study what really interests them. But I require that they conduct original research. Their papers can't be a rehash of what's already known, must make a meaningful contribution to knowledge. And ProQuest allows faculty to make with confidence the requirement that every paper be based in primary sources. With ProQuest at their fingertips, even undergraduates who are not history majors learn quickly that they're just keystrokes away from films and documents that will empower them to learn and communicate something new. Say, for example, a student wants to evaluate the impact of the outing of Congressman Barney Frank in 1989. The LGBT Thought and Culture collection includes articles such as this one, and the Studies and Video collection includes Let's Get Frank, this documentary film. Students and researchers can, of course, make excellent use of the database LGBT Magazine Archive. Here's a great article, for example, from the Los Angeles Advocate in 2008 that reveals some of the ongoing struggles of bisexuals, even within the LGBTQ community. But many of ProQuest databases that aren't dedicated specifically to LGBTQ content can also provide great resources. So plugging the search term homosexual into the religious magazine archive, for example, generates more than 5,000 hits, which can obviously be narrowed down by time period, religious denomination, and reveal the evolution, or lack thereof, of the attitudes of a variety of religious sects. And a quick search of the database Law and Society Since the Civil War produced gems like this one, from 1957, J. Edgar Hoover Official and Confidential FBI Files, Supposed Homosexual White House Employees. I had a terrible time getting this talk finished because I kept getting lost in these searches. There is so much rich fodder for so much wonderful research. LGBTQ history is fun, interesting, and important. ProQuest offers students and scholars ways to understand, develop, and promote this dynamic and rapidly growing field. Obviously, I only scratched the surface in this whirlwind sampling of LGBTQ history. Thank you for coming along for the ride, and I'm happy to take any questions or comments.
Thanks, Nancy. That was really, really fascinating. I enjoyed hearing all of that, and thank you for all your kind words about ProQuest. We do have a lot of materials to support this research. Clearly, it's a growing area of scholarship. But that's really what we do when we think about our new products and our product launches, is we really are looking at research output and trying to support scholars, young students, young researchers, librarians, faculty alike, with new products that will support this growing area of research. So I don't have anything other to say to you, but I wanted to thank you all so very much for attending this. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. We'll be sending you a thank you email, of course, but I wanted to open up the floor to anybody if they had any questions for Nancy about her research or anything that you heard today. You're welcome to put a question into the Q&A if you like. Let me just see, I think we have a question here. Nancy, is it possible to get a reading list of resources you mentioned in this webinar? Such a great presentation.
Oh, how nice. I have, perhaps more than anyone wants, a pretty extensive bibliography. When I started doing this, that was kind of easy to do. It's gotten, much, much larger. But yes, I do have a bibliography that I'm happy to share. And people can email me directly. Also, now, Barb, is there a way that we could post that bibliography?
Yes, absolutely. So any questions that we get here if we happen to run out of time, we'll definitely post the Q&A at the same location where the ACRL recorded webinar will be housed, but also we can include it in our communications with the customers who registered, not only registered, but also attended the webinar. So we're happy to share that, whatever Nancy shares with us.
Great.
Okay, any other questions from anyone? I don't see anything in the Q&A at the moment, but we'll just give people a couple of minutes if you wanted to type in a question, or you're certainly welcome to unmute yourself and ask your question directly as well. Are you tracking the use of they pronoun initiatives?
Am I tracking that?
Yes.
I have not tracked that. I mean, I really am. I mean, I guess that counts as history. But no, I haven't been doing that. I think that is a very worthwhile study to undertake, but it isn't one that I've taken up.
Okay. And another question here is, how did you become interested in homosexuality throughout U.S. history?
Well, As an American historian, I'm interested in everything in American history, and I'm particularly interested in getting people excited about it. And I think that, I mean, many of you know, one of my real frustrations is students say to me, "Oh my God, you know, I just love this class. It was so interesting," because they expect all history classes to be dull. And so the bar is set pretty low. So I think it's because, you know, there's a certain, you know, rote set of things people have to learn. They don't understand how this applies to them. I think that all history should be, you know, exciting, presented as exciting and interesting, you know, because it is. And LGBTQ history is simply one aspect of that. And once you know it, there's no way that you can look at the remainder of history in the same way. You can't silo these off. That, you know, they all belong together, and it's been a particularly exciting field for me because I'm 63 years old, so I have really seen this field unfold so dramatically over the last couple of decades. It's just a really exciting, fun, you know, really lively area of study.
Okay, there's several other questions coming in here. Okay, so. Let's see, the next one was, did American/European negative views of queerness influence or was it influenced by other countries, do you think?
Boy, that is really a very good question and kind of beyond my expertise. I am unfortunately of the generation of scholars that was trained just to do U.S. history in this little silo, which is obviously the wrong way to do it. So I don't know a great deal about that. I mean, I've had to learn some aspects of African history, pre-colonial Africa, and so forth. But again, I have to confess my ignorance and say that's an excellent question, and I wish I had a good answer to it.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Do you have any other articles or writings in the works regarding the influence of homosexuality on U.S. culture?
Well, that's really an interesting question. I have a couple articles and then the chapter in my book that I mentioned. I am mulling over the idea of putting together a just sort of an overview of gay and lesbian history in the United States, and particularly with its impact on culture. Again, because I think this is so important that it not be this sort of siloed thing, as if it only affects the people in that group. This affects, you know, everyone. All of our history is something that incorporates and affects all of us. So I'm mulling over this thought. I'm not exactly sure. There's some wonderful material already out there, and I want to make sure that I'm not duplicating what other scholars are saying. So I have to make sure I find something new to say in ways that is going to be valuable to other people. So I have to give this, I think, more careful thought.
Okay, next question. Where do you see LGBT scholarship heading? It seems general acceptance can improve as scholarship and visibility expands, including trans studies.
I think that is true, and I think it is expanding. My personal bias is that, and I know there are people who do wonderful work in queer theory and so forth, theory. I'm just not a big theory person, and some faculty on my campus can carry off theory very well. I just have struggled with that. I think that the kind of stories that I told today are the things that I would really like to see more of. And I'm a little bit concerned that in some of the graduate programs, some of the books that are sent to me are so theory-laden I can hardly understand them. So my hope is that we can – I mean, theory is important, but I hope it can be presented in a way that isn't going to turn people off and that makes sense. And if whether it's in trans or I think much underappreciated and understudied subfield bisexuality, both of these areas are areas that I think really could use a lot more work.
Okay, next question. Do you have an eye to any other subverted groups and their rich cultures in the U.S., for instance, the disabled, asexuality, people of color, et cetera?
You know, I just finished reading a really great book on the history of disability, and it's one that Kim Nielsen is doing some great work on that. Other people are really doing, you know, great stuff. Paul Longmore really pioneered this at San Francisco State. So that's something that is interesting to me, and I like it because in some ways, like LGBTQ, it's very specific, but it's also very inclusive. I mean, it includes all races, all ethnicities, all economic groups. I like that about these fields of history. So, and I do think that, you know, we need to have more, as the term is today, intersectionality, you know, looking at these and how all of these different things affect each other. What does it mean to be gay and disabled? What, you know, those kinds of questions. So I think that the problem, of course, for all of us is, you know, the bigger and wider it gets, the more that you have to know, which gets kind of, you know, daunting. But on the other hand, there's something very exciting about stretching and moving into new fields and seeing how things interact. So I hope that I will always continue to do that.
Great. Another question. Have you considered reaching out to African American churches to teach LGBTQ history? If not, would you consider doing so?
I don't know. I've never thought about that before. And of course, it really depends on which churches we're talking about, because some have been real leaders in LGBT awareness and AIDS crisis and all, you know, kinds of things over the years, and others have remained pretty conservative. And I think that I have to say perhaps I'm doing a little too much, if you pardon the expression, preaching to the choir. I am happy to accept invitations to speak. I tend not to get out and sort of advertise myself. I'm more reactive than really proactive, although I have been a little more aggressive on this. I don't know that would be welcome, and it's something, and I don't know that I am willing to press. So that's something that I will have to think about. I was thinking about this a lot this last week when I gave the presentation to the high school teachers on how to incorporate LGBTQ history into their classes. And I said one of the big differences between you and me is that my students are college students. They are electing to take this class. I don't get people who are homophobic in my classes. I mean, they are not going to take that class. I think it's very different. It's a different approach. approach when you're talking to, and I think it's even more important work when you're talking to people who aren't necessarily sympathetic or supportive. But that is not work. Perhaps it's cowardice on my part, but not something that I have really reached out to pursue.
Okay. Why do you think that homosexuality became pathological in the late 19th century, besides Teddy Roosevelt? Do you think Freud was part somewhere in that mix?
Well, you know, I think Freud is a part of that mix, but if you read Freud's letters, I mean, I think Freud gets kind of a bad reputation here. I mean, he's more sympathetic and is not all big on what we would call today conversion therapy. But I do think that it's a combination of things. I think a lot of it has to do with simply more possibility in, you know, an urban industrial environment for what we would call today a gay or lesbian lifestyle. I mean, that just didn't really exist very much up until that point. So I think it becomes more visible at a time when the nation is really going through, in some ways, a wonderful time. It's gone from a rural agrarian period to this urban industrial giant. But any big change like that is kind of frightening. It's kind of disturbing. What does it mean to be an American? And then at the same time, to have a growing visibility of people who are participating in same-sex activities, living what we would call our gay and lesbian lifestyle. I think this really, it doesn't happen, what I'm trying to say, it doesn't happen, you know, in a vacuum. There's a combination of things all happening at the same time, I think, that really contributes to this, oh my God, you know, this is, what are we going to do about women who don't want to be mothers, who don't think their highest aspiration is to be somebody's wife? That's very threatening to a lot of people. And so I think that it's not just simply Theodore Roosevelt or urbanization, industrialization. It's a whole combination of things.
Yeah. Have you ever considered creating an OER text for this course or similar courses that other instructors could refer to?
I'm so embarrassed. What's an OER?
Open Educational Resource. It's like open access.
I think my age is telling. I don't know, and I'll have to follow up with you people there at ProQuest, who I'm sure can help me understand what that means and what that might look like.
Okay. What was something especially surprising you learned in your research into LGBTQ history?
Oh, there have been so many surprises, but I remember the first time I read that article, Sodomy in Colonial New England, and, you know, sodomy was a capital offense. I mean, I was assuming these very dour people would literally be death on this, and I was just so surprised that there was this, I mean, when they're going after Nicholas Senchin at the trial, even some of the men who are testifying against him were like, I hate to testify against him. He's a really good guy. You know, the whole community's response seems to be, he's a really good guy, and we wish he wouldn't do this. But it's not like, oh my God, you know, he's a sex criminal. He's terrible. That was just something that he did that they wished that he didn't. It was surprising when you look at the draconian law. I just expected something quite different. So that was the first of so many surprises that came along to me. I would also say, I'm not a big one for heroes in history, but Frank Kameny is one of my heroes, and he is just he was an astronomer during the Cold War, and he loses his job because of his homosexuality. He just can't believe this because he's got a PhD from Harvard. He's doing great work, and he can't get over it, and he takes his case all the way to the Supreme Court. He is not reinstated. He writes to the president, and he devotes the rest of his life to promoting gay and lesbian rights. And he borrows very intentionally from the civil rights movement and says things like, you know, look, why are homosexuals talking about whether or not they can be cured? He says, no black person says, you know, bleaching the Negro is the solution to racial problems. Converting Jews is going to end anti-Semitism. He says, you know, we all want our rights, you know, as he says at the time, as Negroes, as Jews, Jews and as homosexuals. And why we're that way doesn't matter. And it's a brilliant speech, and he's just this amazing character. And he lives long enough to, when I present this in my slides, there's a picture of him with Barack Obama when he's signing in, civil rights legislation for homosexuals. So there are a lot of these amazing stories. Barbara Gittings, another just tremendous leader. Interesting stories about not just gender, but race. You know, what does it mean to be a member of the gay and lesbian community if you are an immigrant to this country when you could be deported if this news comes out? How does that affect your ability to work within your ethnic community, your gay and lesbian community? I mean, there's lots of complexity, lots of different exciting questions and problems.
Yeah. So you talked about this a little bit, but what is your favorite part of teaching LGBTQ history as an ally?
I think my favorite part is just watching my students get excited about this material and having them make connections. Oh my God, in my ethnic studies course, we're just studying, this, or, we're just doing the Cold War in my class over here. There's two responses that really are the most meaningful to me. First of all, the students who, as I think I mentioned, who are LGBTQ, who it means a lot to them personally to have their history being taught. But also those who aren't, LGBTQ, who are straight, but also find this, understand the value of this history and seeing how it really does illuminate and deepen their understanding of American history overall. I think that those are, I'm a historian first and foremost, and when people get excited about history and see it not as just sort of an intellectual exercise, but really a powerful, a meaningful thing that can change the way they live their lives, that's what I really aspire to do, and I'm able to do that in this class because the material lends itself so well to it.
Nancy, thank you so much for spending this extra time with us, and thank you everybody on the call that stayed and listened to all this great Q&A. I think we spent 20 minutes just on questions, so clearly the audience is interested in what you're doing and what you have to say, and we are as well, and I can't thank you enough for your time today, everybody on the call, but Nancy, especially you, for sharing your scholarship and your research with us today.
Well, thank you so much. And again, people should feel free to reach out to me if I can help them in any way. I'm not really, foremost expert in any ways, but I love this material and I enjoy teaching it. And I think that we all have so much to learn. There's so much value here. So thank you very much.
Absolutely. Mark, any closing words you'd like to make? Okay, well, thank you, everybody, and we look forward to having you on future ProQuest ACRL webinar. Thanks very much, and enjoy the rest of your day.